So that brings us to the end of this week's lecture. Banzai, do you have any questions?
I have three, to be specific.
Three.
So the first one is, what triggers autophagy?
Well, that's a very good question, but it's also quite a complicated question to answer. I'll start off by saying that there's always a degree of autophagy which is occurring in cells, a basal level, if you like. Mm. So there's no specific trigger that's required for that autophagy to occur, because it's always occurring. But if the cell is exposed to some sort of stress, that's often a strong signal for autophagy to be triggered or induced. And in the example of starvation, which we saw today, there's a protein in cells which is able to sense starvation, and it communicates that signal to the autophagy proteins. And they're able then to trigger the autophagy process, which forms part of the cell's response to that scenario.
I see. Mm-hmm. So let's move on to my next question,
yep.
which is there any part of the cell which cannot be degraded by autophagy?
That's, again, a very good question.
Thank you.
So as we saw today, there's non-selective autophagy, which is able to remove random parts of the cell. So you'd think that speaking from that, pretty much nothing in the cell should be immune from autophagy. But some parts are actually avoided. And a good example of that is the nucleus. There's basically no evidence to suggest that the nucleus is degraded by autophagy. And that's most likely because the nucleus contains the genetic material, the DNA, which the cell requires to reproduce and survive. So the cell is able to pretty much degrade other things in the cell, but specifically avoid very, very important parts like the nucleus.
Oh, I understand now. Mm-hmm. So my last question would be, it sounds like, and it seems like, the autophagy is really important thing in our cell, for us as well.
Yes.
So if there, what's going to happen if there is no autophagy anymore in our body?
Okay. So in the case that autophagy is blocked, I personally work with yeast, and we often do this. We block autophagy in cells. And if you block autophagy in yeast, you might be surprised to hear that there isn't actually any dramatic implication for the cells. So they appear to grow fairly normally, they don't die immediately, they look pretty normal when you look at them under the microscope. But if you grow them for longer periods of time or subject them to some sort of stress like starvation, then you find that they actually start to die more rapidly than their normal counterparts. Yeah, it seems to play a more fundamental role in longer-term survival and responses to cellular conditions.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any questions?
That was very informative, but I wanted some clarifications.
Yep.
First, are there some parts of the cell that are affected and are not affected by autophagy?
Good question. So if you think back to the first part of the lecture, where we talked about selective and non-selective autophagy, In non-selective autophagy, the cell basically degrades random parts of itself. And in that case, pretty much anything can be degraded by autophagy. But on the other hand, in selective autophagy, the cell is able to specify particular targets. And in that case, an example that's often given is individual organelles. So things like the mitochondria, endoplasmic reticulum, peroxisome can all be specifically taken up by autophagy and degraded.
Nice. Now it's clearer to me that there are specific parts, and sometimes they are not very selective, right?
Yep.
My next question is, are there specific genes that activate autophagy or are involved in autophagy?
That's a very good question, because autophagy is obviously quite a sophisticated process that happens in the cell. And there are a number of genes, I think about 15, that are completely essential for autophagy, and we'll hear about them in more detail next week. But in the absence of any one of the proteins that those genes encode, autophagy is completely blocked. And that's a method that we often use in our research of autophagy.
Thank you for all the clarification. Those made me look forward more to the week two of the course.
Mm-hmm.
So it's much clearer to me, so thank you very much. If there are any other questions, you can maybe put that in the discussion board, and we'll try to answer them too.
And we're looking forward to seeing you for week two of the autophagy MOOC.